Doctor Who, Castrovalva, by Christopher H. Bidmead, read by Peter Davison. Chapter 1, Escape from Earth.
"He's changing," said Adric. "The Doctor's regenerating."
A cold, unfriendly morning had begun to whiten the sky beyond the high-wire perimeter. Tegan exchanged a glance with Adric and Nyssa, but none of the three friends dared to approach the Doctor. For inside that red ocean of greatcoat festooned with a familiar long woolen scarf, the figure on the ground seemed so fragile as to be hardly there at all. They watched him struggle to sit up, and from that strangely smooth and vacant face they heard a voice that was not very like the Doctor's. But the sense of what he said was lost under the crisp intrusion of several pairs of footsteps running towards them across the tarmac. The long pin drop of silence shattered into confusion. In a moment, uniformed guards loomed over them, and above the clamor of the approaching ambulance, Tegan managed to hear, "These are secure premises. You lot have got some explaining to do." As if you could explain something like that to an inquisitor behind the visor of a security helmet. You'd have to retell the whole terrifying story of Legopolis and of the Doctor's last deadly struggle with the Master, perhaps his last forever, high up there on the Pharos transmission tower, in whose ominous shadow they now stood. The guard took hold of her arm, none too gently, to steer her out of the path of the approaching ambulance, while his two colleagues closed in around Adric and Nyssa. Still shattered by the Doctor's terrible fall, Tegan turned her anger on the guards.
"Take your hands off me! This is an official uniform!"
If she had a wild hope that they might somehow be impressed by her purple air hostess outfit, she was mistaken. Adric's tone was more reasonable.
"Don't be silly," said the boy, trying to sound calm. "We want to help, but you can't take us away from the Doctor. Something may have gone wrong with his regeneration."
The ambulance had drawn up beside them, like a white wall suddenly shutting them off from the Doctor. The driver jumped out and disappeared around the other side of the vehicle, and a man in a white coat emerged from the rear doors to follow him. The guards hustled the three companions against the side of the ambulance.
"Arms up and lean on it. Come on, quick!"
Swift, professional hands searched Nyssa and Adric for weapons. As it came to Tegan's turn, she noticed that by craning her head to the left, she could look through the windows of the driving cab to the patch of ground on the other side where the white-coated man was bent over the Doctor. The uniformed driver had returned to fetch a stretcher from the back of the vehicle. The guard concluded his search.
"No weapons."
"Of course not," Tegan snapped. "We're all perfectly harmless, unfortunately."
Looking through the two windows of the driving compartment, she saw the ambulance men lifting the limp figure onto the stretcher. She closed her eyes tight, trying to shut out the reality of what was happening to the Doctor. After a fall from that height, it seemed impossible that he should live at all. And yet, just before the arrival of the guards, they'd all seen him open his eyes and reach out towards the shadows behind him, where his future had been waiting. That surely must have been a dream, thought Tegan, remembering with a shudder the way the vague and luminous figure they had come to know as the Watcher had stepped out into the light, grasping the Doctor's hands and drawing closer and closer until their two shapes began to merge. This was the process Adric kept calling regeneration, a process that all the lords of Gallifrey went through from time to time, except that this time, because of the apocalyptic events surrounding their adventure in Legopolis, the Doctor's new self had overlapped the old, watching and waiting for the moment of union. Adric was still trying to reason with their captors.
"The point of this Pharos project of yours is to track down alien intelligences, isn't it? We thought we'd save you the trouble and come to you."
He looked across at Nyssa for confirmation, and she shook the curls of her chestnut hair in a curt nod. It was unusual for Nyssa to tell anything but the strict truth, but in this case, the strict truth was far too complicated, and it was perfectly true that they were alien intelligences. The disbelieving guards peered back at them. Adric, with his strange smile and wicked black button eyes, might well have passed for a visitor from another planet, for all the guards knew, and come to think of it, the younger of the two girls did have a remote aristocratic quality that was somehow unearthly. But the other girl's broad accent could never have come from anywhere further than the Antipodes.
"We're what you're looking for," Adric repeated.
He was starting to become heated now, forgetting to use a grown-up, reasonable tone of voice.
"Alien intelligences! I come from somewhere up there!"
He jabbed his finger towards a distant spot in the sky with such emphasis that the guards couldn't resist looking up.
That's the way into e-space.
The ambulance man in the white coat looked up too as he was on the point of climbing in after the stretcher. Their hesitation was a mistake, because at that moment the engine sprang into life and the vehicle suddenly began to accelerate across the enclosure with its unlatched rear doors defiantly waving goodbye in the slipstream. Adric had seen what Tegan was up to out of the corner of his eye and been ready for it. Now he gestured to Nyssa. The pair of them ran off after the ambulance at top speed. With a screech of tires, Tegan wrenched the wheel round in a tight U-turn, heading the ambulance back towards her two friends. A long way across the enclosure, she could see the main gates, but even as the plan to escape that way formed in her mind, the gates began to swing shut, and the wail of a warning klaxon fractured the morning air. Nyssa was nimbler than Adric, and had managed to jump up on the side of the ambulance, reaching one arm in through the open window and holding on to the outside handle with the other hand. As Tegan swung away in another 180-degree turn, in the rear mirror she saw two of the guards seize hold of Adric. He struggled fiercely, but as more guards arrived, he was overpowered. Tegan reached across the driving seat and helped Nyssa in, steering perilously with one hand as she negotiated her way between a row of huts. "We'll have to go back for him, I suppose," she hissed. Nyssa was already scrambling over the back of the seat into the rear of the ambulance, where the doctor's stretcher was on the point of slipping out onto the tarmac that raced past below them. "No, the TARDIS," Nyssa shouted, grappling with the flapping doors. "We've got to get the doctor somewhere safe." Adric felt himself being lifted to his feet. "All right, all right. Just let me get my breath back." There was a crowd around him now, and the strange young boy was never shy when it came to being the center of attention, even when, as now, his audience was not entirely friendly. Beyond the crowd, some 100 yards away, where it had materialized in the shadows at the base of the great radio antenna, he glimpsed the blue telephone box that was the outward guise of the Doctor's time machine, the TARDIS. It meant safety, if only he could get to it. Through the windscreen, the two girls could see the TARDIS too. The ambulance was cruising quietly along behind the row of huts, but it seemed inevitable that the big white vehicle would be spotted as soon as they broke cover. The klaxon was still sounding, reminding them that the establishment was swarming with people. There was nothing for it but to take a chance. Tegan glanced back to make sure the doctor was secure on the stretcher, crossed her fingers, and put her foot down firmly on the accelerator. The crowd around Adric heard the whine of the accelerating engine and turned to see it hurtling across the enclosure towards the base of the antenna. As the ambulance reached its goal, Tegan swung it into a skid so that it ground to a halt with the back doors almost touching the time machine. "Get the doctor into the TARDIS," Tegan snapped. There was no need. Nyssa was already scrambling out to open the rear doors. Adric took advantage of the distraction to renew his struggle with the guards now that a dozen or so of the staff were headed in the direction of the ambulance. The guards were heavy, but he was good with his feet. Spurred on by the desperate sense that the TARDIS doors might close him out and leave him marooned forever on this planet of fools and bullies, Adric managed to bring one of them crashing to the ground. In the distance, he could see the girls helping the doctor out of the ambulance. The two guards had Adric's arm pinned behind him securely now, and he paused for breath, watching with very mixed feelings as the doctor and the girls disappeared into the safety of the TARDIS. Only a moment later, the crowd arrived to batter on the firmly time-locked doors. Nyssa reached the door lever just in time. She knew it was the door lever because it was the one controlled in the TARDIS console room that produced instant, simple, and visible results. She surveyed the assembly of dials, buttons, and levers in front of her, and then looked up at Tegan, who had been struck by the same thought. "All this technology," said Tegan, "and there's nothing we can do with it." Nyssa's tone was more practical. "In any case, we can't take off without Adric. The first thing we must do is get the doctor somewhere safe." She turned to where they had left him resting, slumped over the console, and caught sight of the small door that led to the TARDIS corridors closing behind a burgundy coattail.
"Where's he off to now?" exclaimed Tegan, running after him.
Nyssa made a move to follow, but the picture on the big viewer screen caught her eye. It showed Adric being marched across the enclosure by the guards. Was there nothing they could do to help? Adric had not quite given up trying to explain.
"I suppose you realize the doctor's just saved us all from the master, and now he's going to take off, and you'll never have a chance to thank him."
He stopped. No one was listening. The driver had recovered the ambulance, and now it rolled up beside them as they walked towards the main building.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.